church, let's sing. Let our hearts cry out.
You.
Father, we praise you for this morning. We give you honor and we give you glory, Father. You are a good God and your mercies prevail forever. Amen, church. Amen. Say hello to somebody on your left and your right. Give them a elbow.
We're so glad you're joining us, whether you're with us online or in person. Here are a few things you need to know. There are a lot of great things happening at Harvest Time. Here are a few ways you can get involved right now. To check out all things that are going on, scan the QR code or visit us at htchurch.com.
If you'd like to give, you can visit htchurch.com. Click on Give at the top of the page. Use our Realm Connect app to set up recurring giving, or you can give anytime using the Harvest Time offering envelopes.
We have so many amazing opportunities to believe, belong, and be light. For more information on all things Harvest Time, meet us at the Connect desk. We love you, Harvest Time family, and hope you have an awesome week.
You have a 100% chance of success in marriage. You just need to do it God's way.
A strong marriage rarely has two strong people at the same time, but it's often a husband and wife who take turns being strong for each other in the moments the other is weak, and then together realizing that it's Jesus who's holding you.
May the God of hope fill you all with joy and peace as you hold hands with one another.
Good morning, Harvest Time Church. How y'all doing? You guys having a good Sunday morning so far? Who's excited to be in church? Y'all were singing like you were excited to be here. Just one more time. Who's excited to be in the house of the Lord this morning? There's a lot of places you could be, but the fact that you're here, I think you're starting your week off at the right place at the right time. It's great to see you. Welcome to Harvest Time Church. If this is your first or second time, welcome. If this is your home church, welcome home. We really do love starting our week with you and really just being able to hang out together, worship together, sit under the word, sit under teaching together, and just leave encouraged for the week ahead of us. Can I get an amen? Can I get a Pentecostal amen? Pentecostal amens are the best amens. It's not a competition, but it is. I'm just kidding. It's not. Anyways, it's really good to see you. A couple things I want to let you know about. One, if you're interested in having a better marriage, by a show of hands, who would like a better marriage? Great, we'll see you February 18th and 19th at our XO conference. Pastor Jimmy Evans said this, Pastor Glenn, you are my witness. He said you have a 100% chance of having a better marriage. Those are some good odds. I'm not a mathematician here. Mark, you probably would be. I'm not a mathematician, but I feel like 100% chance of having a better marriage is a pretty good chance. So if you're interested in that, please come see me after this service. I'm going to be at the Connect Lounge. We can get you signed up. If you're single, a lot of people, single people have asked, like, can I come? Absolutely. If you'd like to have a good marriage, a great place to start is listening to people who are in the middle of a marriage. I mean, like, look, I can cook a cake. I can bake a cake. See, I can't even cook a cake. You don't cook a cake. You bake a cake. I can bake a cake, but I'd rather find somebody who's really good at baking cakes to show me how to bake a cake. So if you're single, feel free to come. There are going to be single folks that are there, and it's just a great opportunity to just sit under teaching that points to, first of all, Jesus, and second of all, how to put Jesus at the center of your marriage, at your soon-to-be marriage. Maybe you're engaged. Maybe you're dating. Maybe this could be the one. Find out. See if they'll come, you know? If they're like, nah, I'm not interested, find another one. That's my marriage advice. 19 years. If they don't want to come to church or anything about their marriage, find another one. You'll be better off in the long run. I'm just rhyming up here, guys. I'm just throwing everything I got at the wall, seeing what sticks, make it work. Anyway, second of all, I want to let you know that it's not too late to join a life group. If you're looking for community, if you're looking to Find people that you can do this life together with, growing your relationship with Jesus and also growing relationship with others. Please, right after the service, come talk to me at the Connect Lounge. I promise you, or Connect Desk, we've got a Connect group, a life group for you where you could be in community. Sundays are awesome. Don't get me wrong. It's so great to have you on a Sunday. But Monday through Saturday is really where we get together and actually do life and come in here. And that should really just be Sunday should be like the overflow of community. Amen? So come find me after the service. We can help you out with anything. Also, right afterwards, if you have a youth student that's interested in going to our youth retreat, sign up. We got a few spots left. If you have a youth student who's not interested in going to youth retreat, sign up. We have a few spots left. I always tell my kids, you don't pay bills. You get no choice. Until you pay some bills, you do what I say. So feel free to sign your kids up, and I promise you, they're going to have a really good time. But any questions, come talk to me afterwards. So we got a lot of great things that are happening in the life of Harvest Time Church, and we want you to be a part of them. So real quick, before we move on, I want to take a moment and really, first of all, thank you for giving and sowing in week in and week out to what God is doing through your tithes and offering here at the local church. If you are going to be giving yours on the program that you got as you walked in, as you received that, there is an envelope. If you're going to be giving through there, you can put out all of your information, your credit card details on there. Make sure you put your credit authorization code, that 3-digit code on the back, or else Ethel's going to call you this week and ask for that code, and we don't want to do any of that. Like, you got a busy week. We've got things to do as well. If you're going to be giving by cash and want to receive credit, you can do that. Everybody watching us online on YouTube channel, it's so great to have you with us beaming in. From wherever you are in the world, you're going to see a link in the chat. You can click on that to give. You can also give through our website. You can give by text, which is really simple. We are not passing the containers at the moment, so you can drop that in the offering buckets, or really the offering containers at the back doors on your way out. But I want to encourage you with a scripture. And there's this moment in 2 Chronicles, and all of the people get together, and they give this big offering towards what God is doing to finish the temple. And David receives this offering. He says this, and they rejoiced because they had given willingly with a whole heart. They had offered freely to the Lord. I love those three things: willingly, wholehearted, and freely. And because of those three things, they were able to rejoice. Have you ever thought in this moment right here, when we choose to give willingly, when we choose to give freely, when we choose to give with our whole heart, we can rejoice in this moment. So this should be a celebration if you think about it. We should be rejoicing that God is using what it is that we bring willingly, what we bring freely, what we bring wholeheartedly, and because of that, we can just rejoice as a church. Should we just rejoice right now in this moment for what God is doing through being willing to bring to Him what He's first given us? I love that. I pray that as you give weekly or biweekly or however you do it, that every time you give, it's a moment to rejoice. It's a moment to celebrate what God is doing through the local church, through our willingness to give freely and wholeheartedly. Amen? Would you hold your gift in your hand? Hold your spouse in your hand. Somebody's like, I'm coming to the XO conference. They don't want to hold my hand right now. Jesus, we love you. Lord, we thank you that we can find joy in your house. Lord, this isn't a somber occasion. This is a joyous occasion. We get to gather as believers. We get to laugh in your presence. Lord, we get the Holy Spirit conviction in your presence. We get to get better in relationship with you. So, Father, we thank you for this moment. Lord, we thank you for this moment of rejoicing as we willingly, freely, wholeheartedly give what it is you've first given us. Lord, I pray for a blessing on this house. I pray for a blessing over every family, every person who is giving with expectation that your kingdom will go further. Father, we pray for just supernatural multiplication of the offering that is taken in. Lord, let it touch more lives than we ever thought possible. Bless each and every one here, Father. We love you. And in the name of Jesus, we all shouted, amen. As you do that, why don't you turn your attentions to the screen.
Just one word. You calm the storm that surrounds me. Just one word. The darkness has to retreat. Just one touch, I feel the presence of heaven.
God bless you. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Harvest Time. We're so glad that you came to worship the Lord with us today. Didn't our worship team do a great job leading us this morning? That last worship song that we sang together was written in-house, and our worship team wrote that. Isn't that an amazing song, and isn't it great to sing songs that God has given just for the house? Want to welcome everybody that's worshiping with us online today. So glad that you've joined us. This is Communion Sunday, and at the very end of our service, we're going to receive communion together. So if you're worshiping from home, you might just want to quickly prepare a little communion, and you can receive that at the end with us. If you have your Bible or your Bible app, I want to invite you to turn with me to Matthew chapter 11. Matthew chapter 11. I want to talk to you for a few minutes about beyond Galilee. Beyond Galilee. While you're finding your way to Matthew chapter 11, yesterday was Pastor Blaze's birthday. Happy birthday, Pastor Blaze. We love you so much. Your stand-up routine gets better and better every week. But we're so he'll be here every week, he said. And we just appreciate so much, dear Blazes. Matthew 11, going to start reading in verse 20. How many of you know the Bible says that we don't live by bread alone, but we live by every word? How many of you know that some of God's words taste sweet from the get-go in the mouth? And some of God's words taste bitter in the mouth, but if we'll receive them, they turn sweet in our bellies. We're going to share some of those words today. Matthew chapter 11, these are the words of Jesus, beginning in verse 20. The Bible says, then Jesus began to denounce the towns in which most of his miracles had been performed because they did not repent. You should underline those words if you're using a paper Bible. Woe to you, Chorazin. Woe to you, Bethsaida. For if the miracles that were performed in you had been performed in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented long ago in sackcloth and ashes. But I tell you, it will be more bearable for Tyre and Sidon on the day of judgment than for you. Yikes. And you, Capernaum, will you be lifted to the heavens? That's a reference to Babylon. I'll explain that later. No, you will be brought down to Hades. For if the miracles that were performed in you had been performed in Sodom, it would have remained to this day. But I tell you, it will be more bearable for Sodom on the day of judgment than for you. At that time, Jesus said, I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and learned and revealed them to little children. Yes, Father, for this is what you were pleased to do. All things have been committed to me by my Father. No one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son and those to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Following such harsh words are some of the most beautiful words of Jesus, and perhaps some of the most beautiful words in the whole Bible. Come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. Let's talk for a few minutes about beyond Galilee. Every Sunday, I do my very best to bring you God's now word. This week, I started out with two words from the Lord in prayer, beyond Galilee. Since last year, we've been looking at the most wonderful life of all, the life of Jesus. Jesus' public ministry spanned 3 years. The first year was spent in relative obscurity, working side by side with his cousin John the Baptist in the vicinity of Jerusalem. When John was arrested by Herod Antipas, Jesus moved north to his home region of Galilee. And during his second year of public ministry, he experienced explosive popularity. Massive crowds followed Jesus, and he did many miracles. The Gospels tell us that what is written down for us is just a sample of all the things that he did. But in Matthew chapter 11, change is in the air. Jesus is preparing to move on from Galilee. Resistance to his ministry and hostile opposition is building against Jesus. After John the Baptist is executed, Jesus moves to regions beyond Galilee. Who will go with him there? Who will follow him there? I believe the Holy Spirit is calling to us today. Who will follow Jesus beyond Galilee? Will we go deeper with Jesus than just being superficial followers in a crowd? Will we go beyond cautious curiosity? Will we become fully committed disciples? Will we pursue Jesus beyond our comfort zone, beyond what is safe and predictable and within our control? Will we follow Jesus from popularity into the persecution zone? Only true disciples do that. Beloved, listen to me. The winds of change are blowing all around the world, and they're blowing here in America. God is on the move. The Holy Spirit wants to know who will move with him. Looking at Jesus' words in Matthew 11, I have four thoughts from the Holy Spirit about following Jesus beyond Galilee. On your way in, you received a program. In your program is an outline of today's sermon. And if you like, you can listen, watch the screens, fill in the blanks, follow along. If you'd like to have an outline of today's sermon at home, there's a link to a PDF file in the chat section of the live stream. You can click on that. By the way, I hope you enjoy the new camera angles. We're working on getting our graphics, our video picture, and our sound a little better on live stream. So pray for us because we're trying to make that experience as good as we can. Following Jesus beyond Galilee, four thoughts from the Lord. First of all, God will either change people or he'll change people. God will either change people or he'll change people. Beloved, listen, don't miss this truth in Matthew 11. God is mercifully patient and long-suffering with us, but he will not wrestle with us indefinitely. In fact, God says so in Genesis 6, verse 3, my spirit will not always strive with mankind. God calls us. God woos us. God pursues us. But if we refuse to yield to him, eventually he will move on from us and he will seek out others who will say yes to him. If we insist on having our own way long enough, God will withdraw from us and he will leave us to our own devices. That truth is played out all over Scripture. By the way, just so you know, I'm going to preach hard today, all right? Is that okay? I'm going to preach hard, but you know it always ends well, right? So first, the hard truths. Do you know that God almost killed Moses? The meekest man who ever lived, God almost killed him because of stubbornness. From birth, Moses' mother saw that God's hand was on his life in a special way. As an infant, God spared Moses in the Nile River. He arranged for Moses to be adopted by Pharaoh's daughter and then raised, nannied, and nursed by his own birth mother. God spared Moses' life in the desert. He called Moses out of a burning bush to become Israel's deliverer. But because Moses neglected to circumcise his son in obedience to the Lord, possibly because his Midianite wife objected to the ceremony, God almost took him out. God said, I'm not playing games with you anymore, Moses. God legit almost took him out, but Zipporah stepped in and circumcised their son just in the nick of time. No pun intended. But listen, don't miss this. In spite of all that God had invested in Moses, God was prepared to move on from him and raise up another deliverer who would obey him. God will either change people or he'll change people. After God finally delivered Israel from Egypt, they worshiped a golden calf at the foot of Mount Sinai. God said to Moses in Exodus 33, "You take these people, and I'm going to go find a new people who will say yes to me." In prayer, Moses begged God to reconsider. "No, God, consider this is your people." That's something I pray over HTC every day. Listen, in spite of all that God had invested in delivering Israel, 10 plagues humiliating the Egyptian gods, parting the Red Sea, drowning Pharaoh's army, God was prepared to move on to a people who would obey him. God will either change people or he'll change people. It was only Moses' intercession that persuaded God to change his mind. I'm trying to make a case for you in case you don't believe me. In spite of all that God invested in Samson, a supernatural pregnancy, a consecrated life, God moved on from him. One of the saddest verses in the whole Bible says that Samson woke up one day and didn't realize that the Spirit of God had departed from him. God moved on from the negligent priest, Eli. Under his watch, the candlestand in the holy place flickered out, and the Ark of the Covenant was captured by Israel's enemies. The glory departed from Eli's family, and the boy Samuel took Eli's place. God will either change people or he'll change people. God moved on from stubborn King Saul and chose a shepherd boy, David, a man after his own heart. "The Lord has torn the kingdom of Israel from you today, Saul, and has given it to one of your neighbors, one better than you." Listen, in spite of all that God invested in King Saul, God moved on from him. King David's great prayer of repentance in Psalm 51, after he sinned with Bathsheba, he pleads God not to move on from him. "Create in me a clean heart, O God. Renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence, and don't take your Holy Spirit away from me." When Esther was fearful to approach the king on behalf of her Jewish people, Uncle Mordecai warned her, "Know this, if you remain silent, deliverance for the Jews will arise from another place, but you and your family will perish. God will either change people or he'll change people." I told you it was hard. It's going to get even harder, but then it gets better. Beloved, listen. In spite of all that Jesus had invested in the people of Galilee, he was prepared to move on from them. For more than a year, Jesus taught and performed mighty miracles in Capernaum and the nearby towns, but now, using the language of the Old Testament prophets, Jesus denounces those places. "Woe to you, Bethsaida! Woe to you, Chorazin! Woe to you, Capernaum!" Listen, when Jesus says woe, you better say woe. In spite of all the ministry they received, they would not repent. They were stubborn, holding out, resisting Jesus. So Jesus finally moved on from them. God will either change people or he'll change people. Make sure, be very sure, that he doesn't move on from you. Following Jesus beyond Galilee, four thoughts from the Lord. God will change people. Here's another thought. It gets a little harder yet. With great privilege comes great responsibility. There will never be a better Spider-Man than Tobey Maguire. I get an amen for that. And there will never be a more iconic Spider-Man scene than when Uncle Ben tells Peter Parker, "With great power comes great responsibility." The people of Galilee were privileged recipients of mighty demonstrations of Jesus' power over a prolonged period, and Jesus held them responsible for what they witnessed and what they experienced. Prophesying about the messianic era, the prophet Isaiah said, "Call on the Lord while he may be found. Call on him while he is near. Forsake unrighteous ways and thoughts. Turn to the Lord and he will have mercy. He will freely pardon you." St. Paul warned us in Romans, "Don't presume upon the riches of his kindness and forbearance and patience, not realizing that God's kindness is meant to lead you to repentance." There's an expression that we draw from those verses of Paul in Romans 2. It's an old expression, "Don't presume upon grace." By refusing to fully surrender to Jesus, the privileged people of Galilee were presuming upon grace. In the words of Jesus, here's why that's a bad idea. Don't presume upon grace, because God is not obligated to reveal himself to anyone. This is hard right here. Don't presume upon grace, because God isn't obligated to reveal himself to anyone. In Matthew 11, 25, Jesus offers a prayer of thanksgiving to his Father. He says that according to God's own pleasure, God has hidden the way of salvation from the self-confident, and he has revealed it to the humble. No one knows the Father except the Son and those to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Beloved, listen, this is a hard truth to bear, but God doesn't owe it to any of us to reveal himself to us. We are all justly deserving of his judgment and his punishment. The fact that God reveals himself to any of us is pure mercy. Every month, HTC supports a wonderful missionary couple that has worked for decades and decades among the Maasai people in Kenya, Mike and Marigold Cheshire. They've spent their whole lives for the sake of Christ. They've made many, many, many sacrifices. A few years ago, Marigold shared with me that only recently they reached an area where the gospel had never been preached before. Beloved, listen to me. People who are bound in tribal religions live in horrific fear. They're manipulated by witch doctors. They're harassed by demons. If you don't know, it's true. Mike and Marigold shared the gospel, and the chief elder of that village broke down crying, and he said, "This is such good news. Why did it take you so long to get here with this good news?" Beloved, listen to me. If you're privileged enough to have heard the gospel, if you're privileged enough to have felt God's presence, if you're privileged enough to have experienced answered prayer, don't presume upon grace. Not everyone has that privilege. Don't presume upon grace, because God's revelation to us is time sensitive. The people of Galilee were holding out on responding to Jesus. What they didn't know is that Jesus wasn't going to be among them indefinitely. If you have the privilege of receiving revelation from God, the time to respond is immediately. The Holy Spirit says in the Bible, today, if you hear his voice, don't harden your heart. Right now is the time of God's favor. Today is the day of salvation. The very message of Jesus is repent, because the kingdom of heaven has come near to you. To those who open their hearts wide like little children, the spigot of revelation is opened wider and wider. But to those who are wise and learned in their own eyes, as stubborn and proud, the spigot of revelation is closed off. Don't presume upon grace. Here it's getting harder, because we will be judged based on how much light we have received. There's another hard truth in Jesus' words in Matthew 11. Jesus does not hold anything back in his rebuke of Galilee. Have you seen those memes circulating around on social media, things Jesus never said? I want to start out on my own set of memes, things Jesus actually said, you should listen. Jesus says that the people of Galilee will be more accountable than the pagan people who never witnessed the light of Christ. St. Paul argues that very same point in his letter to the Romans. Beloved, listen, this is a sobering truth for America that has been so saturated with the gospel for so long. Still today, around the world, there are billions of souls that have never once heard the gospel, nor even the name of Jesus. We have Christian television and Christian radio and Christian streaming platforms and Christian movies and Christian books and Christian billboards on the highway and churches on every corner and Linus explaining the true meaning of Christmas from Luke 2, Charlie Brown. You really have to work at not hearing the gospel in America. Compared to other nations of the world, we consider ourselves so privileged here in America, but with great privilege comes great responsibility. Listen, parents, this is why we cannot stop praying earnestly for our prodigal sons and daughters who were raised in the church. It really doesn't matter what kind of other success or achievements that they've had in life if they're not right with God. They're accountable for the truth that they've heard and the things that they've experienced. Listen, I say this with a heart full of love and compassion because I have my own prodigal out there. That's why, listen, we need to band together and we need to pray together for those prodigals until they start coming home one by one by one. Here's the hardest part. It's getting harder. Don't presume upon grace, because God counts the enlightened indifferent as being among his worst enemies. Listen, this is powerful right here. Jesus uses shocking words. Jesus, when he returned to Galilee, he relocated from his hometown of Nazareth. Capernaum became his hometown and the base of his Galilean ministry. Jesus compares Capernaum and the nearby towns with Israel's worst enemies. Tyre and Sidon, they were Baal worshippers. They sacrificed children. Sodom, the epitome of wickedness in the Old Testament. About Capernaum, Jesus quotes from the prophet Isaiah when Isaiah rebuked the king of Babylon, "Will you be lifted to the skies?" Babylon was the arch enemy of Israel and the epitome of arrogance against God. In Matthew 12, Jesus contrasts stubborn Israel with Nineveh, who repented when Jonah prophesied to them. By the way, the Ninevites were the inventors of crucifixion. Think about all the sin cities of the world today, centers of debauchery and corruption and oppression. Vegas, Amsterdam, Bangkok, Mexico City and Bogota, ruled by drug cartels, Moscow and Beijing with an agenda for global conquest. Jesus says, if they had received the light that you have received, they would have repented, yet you remain indifferent. Whoa. When we think of final judgment, we think about history's notorious ruthless dictators, the Hitlers and the Stalins, receiving very harsh punishment, and indeed they will, but God says that he counts the enlightened indifferent among the worst of the worst. As my friend Jackson Sinyonga says, I don't say this to scare you, I say this to terrify you. See that you don't, listen, somebody hear a word from the Holy Spirit. It's time you all stop playing games with God. Surrender to him. Surrender fully to him. Don't presume upon grace. Now it starts getting better. Following Jesus beyond Galilee, four thoughts from the Lord. God will either change people or he'll change people. With great privilege comes great Here's another thought. Repentance means to accept Jesus' invitation to an intimate relationship. Repentance means to accept Jesus' invitation to an intimate relationship. Matthew says Jesus denounced Galilee because they did not repent. What does that mean? What response was Jesus specifically looking for from them? What response is he looking for from us? A few thoughts from Jesus' own words. First of all, repentance is an attitude. Repentance is humility toward God. In Jesus' prayer to the Father, he says, God has hidden the way of salvation from the wise and the learned. Jesus doesn't mean scholars and theologians specifically. He means anyone who's wise in his own eyes. It could be a Jerusalem Pharisee, or it could be a Galilean fisherman. Anyone who's self-confident, self-reliant, self-sufficient, self-assured, in control of his own life and doesn't really see the need for a Savior or a Lord. Thanks for the gospel, but I got this. But Jesus has revealed the way of salvation to little children, not physically little kids, but anyone who acknowledges his need for God's help and reaches up to God for it. In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus called that poverty of spirit. Jesus said, without childlike humility, we cannot enter into the kingdom of heaven. We can't enter into salvation. What response is Jesus looking for? Repentance is accepting Jesus' truth about himself and the Father. Jesus said, no one can know the Father except through the Son. The only legitimate way to worship God and to be in relationship with God is through Jesus Christ. To deny Jesus is to blaspheme God. It's to reject something true that God has revealed about himself. Jesus said, if you don't have the Son, you don't have the Father. Jesus is God's Son in a unique sense. Together with the Holy Spirit, the Father and the Son share an intimate, mysterious relationship known only and understood only truly by them. But at the time of God's choosing, Jesus laid aside his heavenly dignity. He put on a body of human flesh. He entered human history born of a virgin named Mary, a holy mystery. He lived a sinless life of perfect obedience to the Father and of service to mankind. He offered his life on a Roman cross as a sacrifice. Jesus said, nobody takes my life from me. I lay it down. It was a sacrifice in our place. And on the third day, he rose again. Jesus said, the Father's given me authority to lay down my life and to take it back up again. He returned to the Father's side where he ever lives, making intercession for us. Repentance is allowing yourself to be persuaded that these things about the Father and the Son are true. What response is Jesus looking for? You doing all right? All right, because I'm getting to the really good stuff in a minute. Repentance is an about face. Beloved, listen, something to take heart in these verses. You can be part of a Jesus crowd for a long time. You can follow Jesus in a herd for a long time and never personally experience his saving work in your life. The people of Galilee heard Jesus teach. They saw him perform many miracles. They ate the fish tacos that supernaturally multiplied in his blessed hands. But then they continued on with their everyday life just as if nothing had changed. Repentance means that you feel sorry for your old way of living and you do an about face. You turn away from it. Following Jesus beyond Galilee means that we grow beyond superficial enthusiasm and we begin a radically changed life in him. What response is Jesus looking for? Now here's the really good stuff. Repentance is an intimate attachment to Jesus. After a very harsh rebuke of the people of Galilee, comparing them to God's worst enemies, Jesus gives the most beautiful invitation in the entire Bible. Come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Listen, repentance, it definitely involves feeling sorry and turning away from our old life, but that's just a part of repentance. The positive side of repentance is that we turn to Jesus. The best part of repentance is that it's pursuing a personal relationship with him. Notice Jesus' invitation. Jesus didn't say, come to religion. He didn't say, come to church. He didn't say, come to HT University on Wednesday nights. He didn't say, come to serve, come to give, come to membership class, come to seminary. Jesus said, come to me. Enter into the closest possible relationship with me. Be joined to me. Learn from me. That's the response that Jesus is looking for. Listen, I can't help feeling there's such an anointing in the first service, and I feel it here again. I can't help feeling that the Holy Spirit is calling. Hey, come on, it's time to follow Jesus beyond Galilee. It's time to stop being just part of the crowd. It's time to commit to him. Following Jesus beyond Galilee, four thoughts from the Lord. God will either change people or he'll change people. With great privilege comes great repentance, means to accept Jesus' invitation. Finally, this worship team, you can come help me. Only Jesus gives us soul-satisfying rest. Take my yoke. Learn from me. I am gentle and humble in heart, and you shall find rest for your souls. To take on a yoke was an expression used by the Jewish rabbis when someone chose to become their disciple. It meant that someone chose to enter into a close mentoring relationship with that rabbi, the way that two oxen are bound together in a yoke. Often a young, strong, enthusiastic ox is teamed with an older, wise, experienced ox so that that older ox can guide him in how to be productive. That's the picture the rabbis use. The old rabbi, the wise, experienced, knowledge one who knows the way, and the young disciple yoked with him. The rabbis spoke of taking on the yoke of the Jewish law. But listen. Jesus hasn't called us to be yoked with the Christian religion or any other religion. He's called us to be yoked in a personal relationship with him. Listen, following Jesus is not a life without a yoke. Following Jesus means we're bound to him and we're committed to pursuing him. Somebody, listen, a yokeless life does not bring any rest, and that's no yoke, man. That's what people want, isn't it? They want a yokeless life. They want freedom. They want independence. They want autonomy. I don't need you to worry about me because I'm all right. I don't want you to tell me it's time to come home. I don't care what you say anymore. This is my life. Go ahead with your own life. Leave me alone. That's what people want. They want freedom. They want to be unyoked. But in the end, somebody hear me, a self-directed, self-reliant, self-serving life brings no peace. Here's a question to ask yourself. Has it brought me peace? Has career success brought peace? Has education brought peace? Has sexual conquest brought peace? Has partying brought peace? Has the perfect guy or the perfect girl brought peace? Has stuff brought me any peace? Has wine brought me peace? No, it will not. Have pills brought me peace? No, they will not. Are you satisfied? Do you have the inner confidence that all is well? Are you at peace with God? If the answer is no, I know where you can find it. Following Jesus beyond Galilee means there's a yoke to bear. There's responsibility. Jesus didn't say, take my mattress. He didn't say, take my couch. He said, take my yoke. Yokes are meant for work. And the work, the task, is to pursue a relationship with him. But somebody listen, and we're finishing with this. His yoke is easy and his burden is light because he's in the yoke with us and he does all the heavy lifting. Beloved, the winds of change are blowing in the world. Listen, things aren't going to go back to normal, all right? The winds of change are blowing. They're blowing in our country. Sometimes we look at it, we say that's a bad thing. No, it's a good thing. God is on the move. Will you follow him beyond Galilee? Stand on your feet and give Jesus, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, a great big praise in this place. Come on, let's give him a good praise. Don't give Jesus a wimpy little praise. Give him a great big praise in this. Come on, he's worthy. He's worthy. He's worthy. He's worthy. I want you to just lift up your hands. Come on, would you just start giving him praise right now? Just offer him the fruit of your lips. Come on, just tell him he's worthy. Come on, let's give him thanks. Let's give him honor. Jesus, we magnify you. Jesus, we exalt you. Jesus, we praise you. You're good. Come on, lift up your voices. Let's sing together. You're good. Give a good praise to the Lord, would you, right now? Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Would you bow your heads with me for one moment? In just a moment, we're going to receive communion. It's our final act of worship. But I feel like the Holy Spirit's calling somebody today. Today, if you hear his voice, don't harden your heart. Today is the day of salvation. Now is the time of God's favor. The way that we respond to the gospel is by praying a prayer of believing on Jesus. wonder if there's someone here today and you've never prayed a prayer like that, surrendering yourself to Him, inviting Him to be your Lord and Savior, entering into an intimate. That's what it means to repent. It means to enter a personal relationship with Jesus. I wonder if there's someone here today, you've never prayed a prayer like that. Maybe you're here and you prayed a prayer like that a long time ago and a lot of water has gone under the bridge. And it's time to pray it again, afresh and anew, for the first time in a long time. While heads are bowed in this place, I just simply want to invite you, if you want to pray a prayer of believing in Jesus with me, I'm not going to ask you to do anything else, but right where you are, just say a prayer with me. If you'd like to pray a prayer of believing on Jesus for the first time, or maybe the first time in a long time, would you just lift your hand real high where I can see it while heads are bowed? Come on, there's hands all over. I'd like to pray a prayer of believing on Jesus for the first time, or maybe the first time in a long time. Would you just lift your hands? Let me see them. Thank you, Jesus. Folks all over the place, thank you, Lord. I want to invite everybody, if you're willing, would you lift your hands and let's pray together and let's invite Jesus to be our Lord and Savior. Let's enter into a personal relationship with Him. I'll lead, you follow in a nice clear voice. Let's pray. Father, thank you for loving me. Thank you for sending your only Son. Jesus, thank you for coming. You lived a perfect life for me. You died on the cross for me. Jesus, I believe you are the Son of God. I believe you rose from the dead. I confess with my mouth, Jesus is Lord. Jesus, I need your help. I need your cleansing. I need your healing. Forgive my sins. Wash me. Make me a new person. Give me the gift of the Holy Spirit. Jesus, I confess you now as my Lord and the leader of my life. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, let's give him a good praise. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Listen, if you prayed that prayer for the first time or the first time in a long time, as soon as this service is over, we have a prayer room. It's across the foyer in that direction. And I want you to just go over. Pastor Ruth and some of our pastors and friends will be there. We just want to pray a prayer of blessing and celebrate with you. Have something to put in your hands before you leave today. How many of you know God is good? Amen. For our final act of worship today, we're going to receive communion together. Hopefully on your way in, you received a little individual serving of communion. If you didn't, our ushers are in the aisles. And if you do need a serving of communion, lift your hand. The room's full, so lift your hand super high so that we write down all the way in the front, Arturo, we have people. Lift your hand real high and just hold it up until an usher gets to you with a serving of communion. While they're doing that, come on, let's sing, "What Can Wash Away My Sin? Nothing But the Blood of Jesus." Sing verse 2. I receive from the Lord what I also pass on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, Jesus took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Let's pray. Father, thank you that you so loved us, that you sent Jesus. Thank you that his body was broken so that we could be made whole. Thank you for the precious blood of Jesus that washes away every sin stain. Lord, you said, you promised, if we confess our sins, you're faithful and just to forgive our sins and to cleanse us from unrighteousness. So now we receive by faith in the cross of Christ everything purchased for us on Calvary. If your heart agrees with that, would you say amen and amen? Let's receive communion together. You can receive the bread and then receive the cup. After the bread, go ahead and receive the cup. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Come on, church, just lift up your voice and give him thanks, would you? Would you just thank him? We thank you. We thank you. We thank you. Thank you, Lord, that we're so privileged to know the gospel. Thank you that we're so privileged, Lord, to feel your presence. Thank you, Lord. I have one final word. And then I'm going to do something a little bit different that I haven't done in a while. But my final word is this. If you're weary and burdened, I want you to remember Jesus is in the yoke with you. And he does the heavy lifting. He's going to do your heavy lifting this week. Amen. Amen. I want to just do something. We're way over time already, so we might as well go a little bit longer, okay? But I just wonder if maybe a couple of our prophetic people in the congregation, some of our leaders in prophetic ministry, I wonder if they have anything from the Lord for our body. Auntie Terry, do you have something? Uncle Brian, come if you do. Joe, I knew you had something, Joe. So any of our other prophetic people just have something on your heart, a word from the Lord. So I'm going to let... Now listen, I'm going to let Auntie Terry go first. This is my friend Joe. Come here. This is my friend Joe, and he leads a prayer ministry in Ridgefield called the Upper Room, and he's very prophetic. And but when you hear Joe prophesy, you're going to hear like something you've never heard before. Okay, so but it's the word of the Lord. I want to tell you. All right, Auntie Terry, come share what you've got.
Good afternoon. During worship, just praising the Lord, and I all of a sudden saw a picture of an alarm clock, and it kept going off, and it kept getting louder and louder, and I saw a hand kept hitting the snooze button, and it kept hitting it and hitting it, delaying the time of coming awake. And I had no idea what it meant. I felt like, wow, that doesn't seem to fit here. But then Pastor Glenn started to speak. And after I saw the alarm clock, I saw angels ascending and descending over this house. And I felt the Lord say, don't keep hitting the snooze button. I'm calling you awake. I'm calling you now. It is time sensitive. We all want to be a part of what God is doing here and in the earth. And I even felt like somebody's had kind of a funky experience this week with an alarm clock going off when it wasn't supposed to. And if that's you, that's just the Lord confirming that this is something you need to hear and to do.
Also, during worship, the Lord gave me a vision of a very large funnel over harvest time. And it was presence of God coming through that funnel to us. And there's a certain place under that funnel that you have to be in order to receive it. So he showed me that some of us are lacking in answers to prayer at times, or we've been waiting a long time for certain things to happen. And he showed me that it could be that we're on the outside perimeter of that funnel. So he said, get under it. And he also showed me that there's somebody here that's having difficulty with their eyes. And not just bad vision, but vision that's getting worse, and you're concerned that you may not keep seeing. So if that's you, he's here also for healing today. Whether it's that issue or any other, he can take care of that today.
Praise God, praise God, praise God. Hallelujah for prophecy. You know, in 1 Corinthians 14, it talks about that prophecy is about encouraging the body of Christ. And that's what we're called to do, is to encourage the body of Christ. Paul talks about the fact that there's a lot of gifts of the Holy Spirit, but he says desire mostly the gift of prophecy so that we can encourage the body of Christ. And that's what we're here to do. Amen. So as Pastor was sharing the word of God, God was leading me to a scripture in the Bible that talks about that we should be like eagles. We should mount up like wings, like eagles, and that we shall be able to run and not be weary. We shall be able to walk and not faint. Hallelujah. Amen.
Mostly just to encourage and to support what Terry and what Charles is saying. I just felt so much power and presence as Pastor was preaching, and all I was hearing is that if we do repent, what Pastor was saying, then we will see that glory that we are looking for. Some of you are looking for something bigger. You're looking for something greater. You're looking for something that you're not sure where to find it. It is in that repentance, turning around, and that's what I was feeling God impressing on me.
Come. What do you have? What do you have for us?
The Lord conveyed to me that I should say these words in spite of the fact that I'm deathly afraid of public speaking. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. Amen. Thank you. Matthew 6:33.
Amen. You see this is what it means. This is what it means to be yoked together with Jesus, right? So this is what it means to be yoked together. He does the heavy lifting. Awesome. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Joe, I knew you had a word from the Lord. So and just let it go. So just listen, receive the word from the Lord.
Justice, 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 God says, in time for the kingdom. For my nations will be birthed with love and peace and joy. My children will see things in the Spirit, and they will begin to walk in the Spirit. All of you have seen things in the Spirit. For my nations will be seen as holy fire, altars of love, caliente fire from above. Your man, my child, my gift, your love. This is the way we go, children. We walk together, all together, in the nation, and we will see things birthed in the days ahead. You will all see the kingdom of God coming. It'll be like a fire from above coming down on the earth. And all my children will be seen as holy ones of God, walking with the love of God and the peace of God. For I have so much to give you in the days ahead. You have a mind of fire coming down on your mind, for your children will be birthed with feet of fire in the days ahead. They will walk with me, and they will go where I tell them to go. No man knows this, for I have placed this down on the earth. Each one of you has a gift. I have placed it in your heart. You are changing the atmosphere where you go. It's a time to release the kingdom gifts of fire on the earth. So many will see holy kingdom coming, and you will know the time. For I have so much planned for you. It's coming soon, and justice on the earth will be my justice, not man's justice as you see it now. For they do not know me. They say, we are the ones in charge. But I say, I hold the keys to all things, and no man shall know, for I have the plans. April 4th, feet of fire coming forth. He loves you, and he says, this will be all for you, for I have given all of me for you too. Justice and fire, this is the way.
Hallelujah. Come on, let's just give thanks to the Lord for his word. I don't know. Does anybody feel like just celebrating right now? Come on, let's just celebrate. Worship team, let's just celebrate, and we're going to go. God be with you. You're going to have a great week because Jesus is doing your heavy lifting. God bless you, everybody. Come on, let's worship, and then we'll go.